K-Merrick.
Debate concerning the age of the Ibadan Bar and the Lagos Bar, which is my branch. And the jury is still out on which of the two branches of the MBA is truly the premier bar. I'm specially privileged because of my affiliations to both cities. I can claim direct membership of the Lagos branch and adopted membership of your own great branch. So I will not join in that debate. My thing tonight is centered around lawyers stepping forward to take charge and turn our country around. Lawyers being alive to our responsibilities in charting a new course for Nigeria. As you all know, we're indeed going through very, very difficult times. There's insecurity all over the land. No part of the country is safe. There are no jobs. We have an unemployment rate of nearly 40%, the highest ever. Our currency keeps losing value every day. Inflation is at a high of 19%. Government revenues keep dwindling. Infrastructure is collapsing. 13 million of our children are out of school. And regardless of the recent experience of the pandemic, our healthcare remains very poor. Generally, we're in a bad place. Many believe that our country has never been so divided. Boko Haram, IPOB, herdsmen, Okada riders, calls for breakup or acute restructuring, religious extremism, ethnicity, breakdown of law and order, court workers strike, threats of labor strikes, failing institution, and kidnap for ransom has become our nation's most lucrative economic innovation. So my speech today is not about placing blame for Nigeria's difficulties at the doorstep of anyone or any group. The thrust of my speech is to identify what we as lawyers can, should, and must do to turn our country around and make us, in the shortest possible time, a self-respecting first world state where the rule of law prevails. In the early years, Nigeria showed great promise. The whole world expected us to be the giant of Africa, the leading black country in the world, and one of the top economies of the world. As a child, I recall that the University of Ibadan and the University College Hospital were world-class institutions, admitting students and patients from developed countries. Admission into the university was strictly based on merit. After graduating from the university, you had multiple job offers and could choose to take up a suitable offer that aligned with your career trajectory. You could travel across Nigeria by road at any time of the day or night without fear of being robbed, kidnapped, attacked by unknown gunmen and bandits. Police officers discharged their duties professionally, and there was hardly any reported case of police brutality. Indeed, rogue police officers or rogue Nigerians were treated like pariahs and were not embraced as we see in today's world. On the economic front, Nigeria was described by the World Bank as a rising economic frontier, ahead of Brazil, Malaysia, China, and Singapore. All these countries today have become first or nearly first world countries. We had functional industries across Nigeria, and we exported groundnut, cocoa, oil palm as the world's leading producer of these crops. Our balance of payments was in enlarged surplus, and we had a healthy foreign exchange reserve. Our currency was stable and stronger than the US dollar, and at par with the pound sterling. Today, however, and I'll try and mimic my daughter's voice, everywhere choke. We no fit breathe. Our airflow has been restricted. Everywhere just choke. So, we have so many issues and challenges buffeting our country from all sides. So the question we need to ask ourselves as lawyers is this: how do we get out of where we find ourselves today? What must we do? One of the core pillars of constitutional democracy is the rule of law, which is a concept that everybody in this room is familiar with. You will all agree that upholding the rule of law is an essential pillar in guaranteeing the Nigeria of our dreams. In my respectful view, lawyers, whether at the bar or the bench, are the primary guardians of the rule of law and play a critical role in shaping the destiny of any country. According to Marx's theory, a society's superstructure is its legal, social, cultural, and political institutions, which are based on its economic systems. Flowing from this, there's so much we can do as lawyers to help rebuild our country through the development and implementation of frameworks for enduring institutions that will aid good and fair conduct by all. Undoubtedly, if our laws are retooled and made to work, the infamous phenomenon in Nigeria of the rule of strong men instead of the rule of strong institutions will change for the better. There are many angles to the mistrust and injustice fueling many of the problems we face in Nigeria today. I believe that we can, through public interest litigation and by paying careful attention to the bills being considered by the National Assembly, especially those bills on proposed amendments to the Constitution, address certain specific issues. Issues of political restructuring and inclusiveness of power from the center to the federating states. Issues of policing and security architecture. Environmental rights and protection. Human rights enforcement. And ensuring an enabling environment that attracts patient capital, which creates jobs and grows an economy. public interest litigation can compel compliance with the provisions of our constitutions and our laws, can hold public bodies and elected leaders to account by ensuring that they make appropriate decisions, act fairly and transparently within the remit of their powers, help develop the law by giving the judges the opportunity to interpret legislation, give vulnerable people a voice by highlighting important issues which enable them to advocate for their rights, whilst raising awareness of important issues by encouraging public debate and media coverage. Don't worry, I'll soon be done. I know I'm between you and dinner, so I'll move quickly. I am aware that the MBA section on public interest and development law, the 2021 annual conference themed The Role of Public Interest in Governance in Nigeria, will hold in Ibadan next week. This conference could not have come at a better time. I expect that some of the issues raised in tonight's speech will be discussed at the conference with clear action points for implementation. Secondly, the 2023 general elections are not too far away. In every way, good governance is a function of good leadership. And good leadership can only come from electing people who are visionary, focused, and results-oriented. As you're aware, and you all know, many of our politicians have started gearing up for these elections. That's the 2023 elections. We've been seeing posters and commentary all over the place. They're all working hard in the way they know how to do to succeed our present elected leaders. Sadly, from the antecedents of most of these folks, we know that they are positioning to enter office, but do not have the vision or the capacity to lead our nation, and do not have the patriotic zeal to start the process of moving us to a secure, fair, lawful, well-governed, and economically strong state. Accordingly, we as lawyers must collectively and individually do everything within our power to ensure that our political parties present for high public office only the best candidates available. People who, by what they have achieved, what they do, and what they say, demonstrate the capacities to lead our country into greatness. We must, through strong and effective public discourse, debates, and enlightenment, set the bar for the quality of candidates that a party truly desirable of governing this nation must produce. We must encourage our people to reject candidates of doubtful capacity and tainted pedigree. Lawyers who are already in political parties must advocate and insist that their parties adopt these standards. I encourage our ethical lawyers who are so inclined to participate in the electoral process by seeking elective positions or ensuring that the electoral process is free, fair, and provides a level playing field for participants. We must all ensure that we abide by our electoral laws. Thirdly, lawyers who are engaged in election-related litigation matters should ensure they are guided by the rules of the best professional conduct in the discharge of their duties, and they must resist any attempt or temptation to taint or compromise the litigation process. We must stand as strong apostles in the temple of justice, acting fairly, diligently, and in adherence to the rule of law. We must act using our best efforts, shorn of greed, self-absorption, selfishness, slovenliness, and we must be able to contribute to creating a great society where peace and justice reign, where everyone is treated fairly, and there's strict adherence to the rule of law. We must also achieve a safe, secure, and economically strong country. Each time I speak on these issues, many people think that I advocate something that is difficult, utopian, and unachievable in our circumstances. I totally disagree. All we need is a few good people catalyzing the process. Those few good people can arise from your bar in Ibadan here. We just need to take the first baby steps. Reform in most countries that have now achieved first world status was led by lawyers, philosophers, and thinkers. Admirably, the Ibadan Bar has produced some of Nigeria's finest and most respected politicians and thinkers, including the first premier of the Western Region, Chief Obafemi Awolowo, SANGCFR, Chief F.R.A. Williams, QCSANCFR, the first lawyer to be conferred with the prestigious rank of Senior Advocate of Nigeria, Chief Remy Fanikayode, QCSANCON, Chief Justice Sir Olumuyiwa Jibowu, the first Nigerian High Court judge, the first African to serve on the Supreme Court of Nigeria, and a Chief Justice of Western Region, Justice Akinola Aguda, CON, Justice Kayode Esho, CON, Chief Justice Atunda Fatai Williams, GCON, Justice Charles Madarikon, CON, Chief Justice Sir Danley Alexander, GCON, and Chief Bolaige, SAN, all of blessed memory. These greats all participated in shaping the country's political history, and they were all Ibadan boys. In our early years, lawyers pioneered Nigerian politics. We cannot now abandon the political space for others who are less learned, less understanding, and less committed, and then expect to see positive changes that we desire. It can't happen. So we must step forward and stand up to be counted. In conclusion, as Christopher Alexander Shakpara Williams, the first indigenous Nigerian lawyer and chairman of the Nigerian Bar Association from 1900 to 1915 once famously said, "A lawyer lives for the direction of his people and the advancement of the cause of his country." Let me summarize as I close by stating certain specifics which as lawyers we should seek to implement so we can contribute to the process of rebuilding our country. One, we must hold all our elected and appointed officials in the executive, legislature, and our appointed judicial officers accountable, all of them. They must, in the execution of the functions of their office, abide by the provisions of our constitution and the tenets of their office, or we all join hands to call them out without fear. Two, we must call out and, if necessary, encourage the disbarment of all lawyers who are not faithful disciples in the temple of justice. So we must first start by purging ourselves. In the same vein, we must watch over our judiciary such that only the capable, most hardworking, fair, and honest remain, who act without fear or favor, and who dispense justice fairly and in accordance with the provisions of the law. Three, We must carefully monitor the selection process in our political parties and seek all lawful ways to force each party to select only their very best candidates for elective office, and definitely for the highest offices of state. Only visionary, fair, firm, honest, passionate, committed, and hardworking leadership can pull us out of our present problems. So we as lawyers must determine and publish leadership criteria and sensitize all our people in all the nooks and crannies of our country on the type of leaders we must have. Number four, we must pay even more careful attention to every bill that is being considered by our legislative houses to ensure they're in compliance with the rule of law, that they do not conflict with our constitution, that such bills are socially fair and efficient, and are supportive of the building of a strong and virile economy. Of great importance are the amendments now being proposed to our constitution. I urge all lawyers of the Ibadan Bar to please pay careful attention to these amendments. We must engage ourselves actively in all the amendment debates. Amendments that enable more decentralization and greater autonomy for our federating units must be encouraged. It is time to prune our exclusive legislative list to not muchman the items in the list set out in the 1963 Constitution. Five, and finally, we must contribute to the rebuilding of our value systems, starting from our homes and our offices. Our children and adolescents must be taught what is right and what is wrong, and the path to toe. What is good and what is bad, what is fair and what is just, integrity and transparency. All qualities that many of us that grew up in this town learned. A rekindled value system sets the foundation of a great country. My Lord, distinguished guests, members of the executive of the MBA Ibadan branch, may I respectfully suggest that the Ibadan branch sets up a standing public interest committee that implements or monitors some of the suggestions being made today, so that we can enhance the rebuilding of our country. Lawyers have a duty to force the building of a great country. And I dare say that every society reflects the quality of its lawyers. So, if we have issues in our society, we lawyers need to take a careful look at ourselves. If Nigeria has become a nation of villains or slackers, we lawyers must accept that shadows of those profiles may lurk in the reflections we're keen to avoid in our mirrors as we look at ourselves each day. In truth, Ibadan has always been associated with pace-setting efforts and groundbreaking developments in history. The General Conference of Representatives of All Nigeria was held in Ibadan in 1950. This conference was the precursor to constitution making in the form we know today, and in the determination of how we wanted to cohabit as a nation. Honestly, we probably should have stayed with a derivative of that constitution or the constitutions that were made as a result of that conference. And I know that Nigeria would be a much greater and a much better country if we had done so. In the past, Ibadan was home to the tallest building in West Africa, and Ibadan housed the most modern stadium in Africa. This ancient city had the first television station in tropical Africa. Ibadan, as the capital of Western region, was famous for having the best judiciary in Africa and in the Commonwealth, and the best lawyers in Africa. Ibadan had the most astute, hardworking, and patriotic public servants. The policies formulated by the government in Ibadan set the pace for a 7% average GDP growth rate for Nigeria from the years 1956 to 1972. If Nigeria had continued on that growth trajectory today, or by 2005, Nigeria would have attained first world status. I urge you, all members of the bar located in this great city, to please lead the way by leading the entire Nigerian bar in our contribution to national rebirth. As I sit, I'd like to quote the words of Lee Kuan Yew. Lee Kuan Yew, the former Prime Minister of Singapore, probably the greatest leader of the 20th century. He dragged his country from being a fourth world state to the first world in less than 40 years. He was a lawyer and a statesman. And he was in awe of Nigerians when he went to school in Cambridge, because the Nigerians that were in his class always beat him in class. Always did. He had three Nigerians in his class and they beat him in class. So he looked forward to Nigeria becoming a truly great first world country if they produce such persons. Unfortunately, that hasn't happened. In his words, he says, the key ingredients to the successful development of a nation is the quality of the people in charge of that nation. Every nation needs good, visionary men, and I dare say women, to have good government. Good government facilitates the rapid and qualitative development of any nation. A country that has bad leaders will bring harm to its people. And I repeat, a country that has bad leaders will bring harm to its people. Gentlemen of the bar and distinguished guests, my Lord Chief Judge, my mom, my brother Attorney General, and my brother Leonard Silk, and Leonard Silk's in the room, distinguished ladies and gentlemen,